All right, so we're starting with chapter 21, fabricated techniques and practices. As far as the practice side goes, we're going to be doing a lot of that in the lab once we start going on two. So I'm just going to pick a few things through this chapter to kind of just talk about. And there's not going to be a whole lot of stuff up on the board, so we're just going to be following. So for the video, you'll have to be following along in the book. When we talk about the objectives in this chapter, the very first thing is that it says explain the various safety issues related to fabrication. We've kind of covered a lot of that in terms of the welding lab anyway. So that all kind of carries over, although we do have a couple little aspects to talk about. So what we're going to be dealing with back there is, besides all of the welding stuff, is that we're going to be dealing with grinders, bench grinders, hand grinders. We're going to be dealing with a shear, which is essentially what we call an iron worker, who's got a number of different fixtures. We've got a number of saws back there. We've got chop saw, we've got vertical and horizontal band saws. And so dealing with that stuff does come with a couple other safety related issues. As far as the grinding goes, so general rule of thumb on a bench grinder is that you don't use gloves, which could get snagged into the grinder. I have a little bit of an issue with just a blanket statement like that, just because we're dealing with steel, and when you're grinding on steel, it gets pretty darn hot pretty fast. So, obviously if we're dealing with something kind of chunky like, welding gloves like this, this is going to be the possibility of getting those things snagged in there. I don't put on our list that we have to have work gloves. If you want some work gloves, that's fine. One of the other things that we do that back there is that we're using a pair of locking pliers. You may know them as vice grips, since they're technically locking pliers. And maybe something like just tightening it down like this, and then taking it and grinding your edge with this. Now, this keeps it further away from our hands, that wheel. So that's a good way for us to take care of not getting our fingers stuck. Because if this thing grabs, it's fine. Just let it go. We can replace these guys, but it does inherently come up with a little story there. We had a student who he tended to kind of try to hurry up on some of the projects. And occasionally he'd cut a piece, need to grind it up a little bit or whatever. And he would run over to the bench grinder and with just his gloved hands, even a small piece would get on there. And I'm like, I stopped him one time and said, listen, you know what the procedure is, go grab some locking pliers. Use the locking pliers. Keep your hands away from that wheel. Well, I was in a hurry. Well, the problem is, in a welding lab, we don't ever want to be in a hurry. There's too many things that can go wrong, okay? So, very next day, he did it again. And then he came out of that door right there, holding his thumb, with blood squirting out of his hand, because he got the thing stuck in the ground. Took off the nail, and it was not a good sight. So, I said, what the heck? And then it hit me. I'm like, really? I just told you that yesterday not to do that, and you went ahead and did it again. And sure enough, that's what he did. Now, we do want to make sure, again, I've mentioned it before, but we do have the full face shields. So make sure that if you've got glasses on, all three of you have glasses, put the face shield on too, just an extra added protection. I mean, it's not going to protect you 100% of the time. Just last semester, I had my regular glasses on, and I had the face shield on, and and I had a grinding wheel kind of explode on me a little bit, and it kind of hit me in the chest and came up my face, and it kind of gave me a couple little scratches, but I could feel something got in my eye pretty quick. Well, you know, so I did one of these things, kind of see if I could get it out, and it felt fine. I'm like, okay, well, that's a good sign. Next day, it started kind of bugging me down in the corner of the eye. I asked my wife, I'm like, do you see anything in the corner of my eye? She's like, no, I don't see anything. It just looks red. I'm like, all right. So the very next day, I'm like, this is killing me. I got out of the shower. I do this, and as soon as I open my eye up in the mirror, there's a chunk of steel right in the center of my eye. The doctor said, yeah, sometimes where you're injured isn't exactly where you feel it. That's why you were feeling it over in the corner, just the way the nerves hit. You know, so things happen. I mean, I felt I was covered and everything. It still happened, you know. So, so they had to pull that out, and which is also really fun when they go, when they come at you with a little drill to drill a hole out and go, don't move. You're kind of going, oh. So that was kind of fun. On the hand grinders, now understand, okay, so we have guards on these hand grinders, okay? Now, here's the weird thing about a guard, is that sometimes you have to take the guard off for certain things, because we have different wheels that we need to put on there, and if a guard is on there, it doesn't really work right, because we may be going for a technique with a sanding disc or something like that where we got to go straight down with it, versus going to the edge of it. And so we have to take those guards off. But if you're using it as a regular, just using the edge to clean out a weld or something like that, make sure you're using, make sure nobody's left out one of the ones without a guard. Because we do have those too. We've got a couple of them. And another thing that I kind of want to mention is that we have a brand called Metabo. I don't know if you've ever heard of a Metabo before. Towels are really, really nice hanging grinders. You kind of have your Milwaukee's and DeWalt's and then you have the towels up here. Milwaukee's and DeWalt's, usually those type of ones, they have a pressure-sensitive trigger on it. So you got to hold it to keep it going, and if your hand comes off, it just shuts off. That's not how the towels work, so understand that we have a switch on it that we can switch on and take our thumb off of it, and it will stay on that way. We have a couple older ones, and just kind of keep in mind, always double check your switch, because we had an incident where someone was using one of these Metabos that was running it, and they must have snagged something or moved. Well, it pulled out of the wall socket. Okay, great, that happens. Well, they just put it away. I put it on the bench. I went to plug it in. Switch was still on. And went, phew, off the table, came down on the ground, hit perfectly, and bounced straight up into my leg. So it was a cutting disc, and it snagged my pants and ripped my pants up. But luckily, it was a thin cutting disc and kind of blew apart. I was like, ah, jeez, you know, it was just one of those. Just happened, and it happened really fast, and then you're kind of going, wow, okay, that just happened. So always double check those switches. Now, for me, I just went, oh, I ruined a pair of pants, until later on I felt my sock was all soggy, and I actually did cut myself, gash about that long. Just kind of keep that in mind, because we are using these Metabos back there. Not everything is Metabo, but most of them now are Metabos. We're back there using the hand grinders. As far as the ironworker, so basically we were using that for the most part for the plate shear on it. But understand that the whole thing inside of it moves. So there is blades for cutting angle iron, for cutting square stock, round stock. There's a notcher that comes down, and you can notch out angle iron to create 90s. All of that moves, even though you're only using that shear. So if someone's sitting there just waiting for you to finish, and they've got their hand stuck in one of those little notches, now they don't realize that you push that pedal down, you're getting fingers down in the hopper, because it's not gonna take much to chop someone's fingers off. So when you're back there on that, just make sure nobody's in the way. Always even double check in the front, because it's a pretty big machine there, and if someone was grabbing steel out of where the pieces are cut, just make sure they're clear before you even start anything. Okay. Saws, you know, the thing with the saws are, you know, you set them up and you gotta have your hands close to them a lot of times. You've got to just pay attention. It's really not a big, here's the safety thing that's going to make it so it's a perfectly safe instrument. No, it's not. You've got blades that are moving out in the open. You know, whether it's a chop saw or horizontal or vertical bandsaw. I mean, the horizontal bandsaw, you kind of get cutting and step away from it, it does its thing. But, you know, for the most part, you still got to kind of watch things and be close to it. So just kind of keep that in mind. Just always be vigilant about people around you and where your hands are, and or pieces of clothing and stuff. We were just talking in the machine shop about a couple of issues. They were using the lathes. And one of the students this morning, nothing happened, but for some odd reason, he decided to wear a knit cap that had a couple of the dangly strings. Well, he tucked them kind of in, but you might not always realize that they're tucked in. We're kind of wondering about the strength of the shape of that cap, if boom, gets pulled into the lathe or not. So, you know, it's always just being aware of your surroundings. Now, as far as fabrication goes, there's a term in this section called a weldment. A weldment isn't necessarily a term that will show up in the dictionary. This is a term that's pretty much specific for welding. So weldment, all it is it refers to anything that was created primarily by welding. That is literally every single project we're going to have is a weldment. So if you see that term, that is what it is. It is our projects. It is basically a project that, or a product that is composed mainly of welding. So that's probably going to come up at some point. Go to the next page here. What is the difference between custom fabrication and fabrication? Any idea? Generally, a custom fabricated piece is a one-off piece. So for just about everything we do back there, it is custom fabrication. We have a lot of tools to try to make those custom pieces as clean and as nice as we can, but it's still a one-off piece. You're creating your own projects, and so everything we're doing technically is a custom fabricated piece. Now, fabrication itself, you can have different ways of doing it, and I kind of lean toward if you're using some kind of fixture system or something where you just slap the pieces in, locking things down, and then start welding. It's more of a production fabrication. It's not necessarily a custom fabricated piece. You don't really see a whole lot of fixtures being made for custom pieces. It may be because maybe you need about, you know, make three or four of them, but you know, that kind of is a little bit of a gray area there. So everything we're doing is really more along the lines of manual work, although we do have some, you know, machines back there that aren't quite as manual, like our plasma cutter or something like that. So let's start with the basic part of layout, and that is marking your steel. So let's go to page 5.6. I just want to kind of mention a couple of things here with the marking of the steel. They show a couple of different types. One is the paint marker, and I like paint markers, but at the very beginning of their life cycle, after a couple of uses, paint markers are not the greatest things. The marker itself starts to get kind of flattened out. Yeah. so you don't get really clean lines, and then the paint itself is kind of dries out fairly fast. So yeah, they're okay, and they hold up fairly well because usually they're a high heat paint. But you know, for the cost of them, I think you can find better products. Now, I've never really used grease markers. Not the biggest fan of grease markers. That's fine if you prefer it. Actually, I go with these two here, basically. Some kind of a Sharpie. Sharpies work pretty good on steel. You can see it for a little while. These do start to disappear a little bit after a point. But was that
being like off and easy?
Yeah, it depends on what you're marking. And then the other one is soapstone. It's just pieces of soap like this, soapstone like this. You know, and it marks fine. You know, it's basically like a chalk. You can wipe it away, but it doesn't wipe away super easy. It will start going away with heat, but you know, you're gonna find that with just about any of them. I'm not a big fan of the chalk lines. Chalk lines really do disappear very, very quickly. And the only time to really use chalk lines were for really long cuts. And even then you might want to mark it with something else. One of the things that I always kind of want to mention, and you know, it's just a good tool to have, is they show a hole punch here. And a hole punch generally is used just to put an indent in the steel before you go to drill it, because that tip of the drill will get in there and it won't get all squirrely on you. And so it'll hold that point right there and then you can drill through. But the multi-purpose part of it is that you can take your line after you mark your line and you can hole punch, get some indents in there into that line. And if you start disappearing through the heat, you can still kind of play, you know, connect the dots as you do that cut. And it especially works well on curves, things like that, which are kind of hard to follow the line, especially as it starts to disappear. So we do like to have one of those or two lying around. So that's a good one to do. We're not going to get into nesting the pieces out and everything right now. If you go to 528, I just want to mention really, really quick, what we're dealing with generally is just sheet steel and plate steel. Just depends on the thicknesses. One's a sheet, one's a plate. We don't really do anything with diamond tread. We don't do anything really with expanded metal. Occasionally, we will do some of the structural shapes. What do you think is the most popular of the structural shapes we'll deal with? Angle iron. Yeah, absolutely. then we have a pipe and tube. What's the difference between pipe and tube? It's actually more so actually how it's made sometimes. Because you can have really thick wall pipe or you get a really thick wall tube. Tube tends to not be quite as circular on the inside as pipe does. Pipe, they do a better job of cleaning, you know, extruding that through. Like this one here is, this is actually tube. And if you kind of look, it's not quite circular when you look through that. So even though the outside is perfectly round, the inside tends to be a little bit off. So you can get tube actually a little cheaper than pipe in those thicknesses. It's actually hard to find pipe in that thickness. It's pretty expensive. Then we'll be dealing with some bar stock, generally round, square. We do have some hexagon stock. We don't have too much other than that. You know, we play around with rebar, but more as decorative stuff. If we're actually doing anything with it, so we do always mention the fact that, you know, using a combination square, nice tool to use for any of the steel. You can set a length and mark pieces multiple times and not have to, you know, sit there and pull out the tape and measure, draw the line. You can just leave it set up and just run your lines every time you do a cut, which is actually pretty helpful because we'll get to the reason why in just a second. On 530, we tend to not use the circle templates too much. We do like to use the compasses, just because we like to work off a set of points. And where the circle template is a really great system for working off set of points. The other thing is, if you ever throw one of those on a nice warm piece of steel, they disappear very quickly. So, fine for paper, not for hot steel. Why I was saying about the cuts. Now, what would be the difference between, say, doing this, running a 2-inch line, cutting it, and then marking it again, versus just going 2-inch, mark a line, go to 4 inches, mark your line, go to 6 inches, mark your line, and now it's already marked, and you can run those cuts. Yeah, because of what's called curve space. That's exactly what that is. That's really the material that is lost, or the space that is that is created through the cutting process. If you've got a saw, the thickness of the saw, that's the curve of the saw. That could be fairly minimal, but you get into a torch, hand torch, every tip that you have has a curve space. So you can get fairly wide on your curve space depending on the size of the torch. And if you screw up and have too big of a torch tip on it, or too small, you know, so those numbers can be all over the place. So curve space is definitely something you kind of watch for when you're doing these pieces in 102. We want you to do as good as you can. I get this question quite often, so I want to kind of lay it out there right now. I get a lot of guys that go, well, how good do these need to be? Well, I want them to be as good as you can make them. You know? I mean, if it's to the point where, you know, your circle is more of an oval, but everything else looks good, yeah, okay, I get that. You know, you're just starting. You need probably a little more practice on the circles. But that's what this is about. But don't come up and, you know, I'm not going to go, well, you know what? This one I want you to be really, really good, but then you can half-ass this one. You know, I mean, you're never going to hear that out of me. So it's not really a good question to come up and say, how good do you want it to be? I want it to be as good as you can make it, and I'd like every one of them to be really damn good. But, you know, again, I understand because it's a beginning class versus, say, you know, fatten something up at the end of a full program. Hopefully there's a difference. When we look at tolerances, you know, that is really what we're talking about is tolerance. And I'm not going to deal with tolerances too much at this point. I'm not putting tolerances on our procedures, and I'm not putting tolerances on our prints at this point. Need to try to be as good as I can. And that is absolutely fine with me. If you go over to 540, I just want to kind of mention a couple items here. When you're back there, because generally we're kind of working by ourselves for the most part, depends on what tool is really going to make sense. C-clamps are fine if you're working with someone else because really it's a two-handed operation to run a C-clamp. So C-clamps aren't necessarily the best thing for a single person to be using trying to hold pieces together. And really that's kind of where the locking pliers come into play because you can definitely, you know, get things, hold it down, get things together with that, with a one-handed operation with that. Now, as far as the type of locking pliers, I do have two different types up here, just so you understand that you'll see two different types back there. This is actually called a groove weld locking plier. This one You can even put another one on this side too to hold this thing together even better. But it allows us to get inside in the middle of it to get a tack down on the ends so we can weld this piece up. So it just gives us space. But it also gives us, it's nice again for, you know, holding on the pieces for the grinder, because it gives us a couple of points that hold it together versus just one little piece like this, because, you know, even regular locking pliers, it's about all they have generally, so you lock those down. The other one, now we have bigger versions back there, but this is also a locking plier right here for welders. This is just one of those nice ones that you can kind of move around a little bit. So say you're just holding down the ends, and you know, you can move this out of the way however you need to, and even weld through the center if need be. So it just kind of clears areas. Plus you can get around things to lock things down too. So these are kind of handy. Like I said, the ones we have back there are much bigger. So it's just a small version. The toggle type clamps on there, those are really fixture clamps. Those are either bolted or welded to a plate, and those are what's used to hold pieces down to create a fixture. Now, as far as C-clamps goes, it's just one of those things that I talked about earlier today, so I want to throw it out there. Does anybody know what a half clamp was? So you got your C-clamp. You got your C-clamp basically, and we want to make a half clamp out of it. So you cut that section off. Now what you can do, get rid of that section. Now we can take this and weld it to a plate. And generally what you do is you weld on this inside, because it's going to push against it this way when you clamp down. So you clamp that down to hold something down, or hold something in alignment, and then you can weld it up. And then when you take this off, back it off, and you just kind of break that tack off. Actually, it works pretty good. Just don't cut my clamps up. Unless it's something we need to do, we'll discuss cutting a clamp up. But yeah, that actually works really well. We used to do that all the time, hold pieces up on the side of the walls or something. Get close to it, you know, get it clamped up there so we can go up there and hold it. So it does work. Let's see here. Let's go to 543. So tack welds. Tack welds, I want to talk about tack welds, and I don't really like the way the book really describes the tack welds here that much. This is just more of an experience for me, but I find that I like a little bit better. You see here, they're putting their tacks, and a tack should be basically just enough weld to hold the piece together before you weld it. Those are really big tacks in the book, so that's a little excessive. We don't need to put that much on there to hold these pieces together. And the where they're putting them on kind of bugs me. If you look at that vertical, there's really no reason to put the tacks where they are there. Because if we start to weld that, we're going to have to weld under the tack, work our way to the tack. Now the tack turns into kind of a speed bump. You got to get over the tack, and you got to weld over the tack and weld. It's not really the optimal place. If you move those tacks out to the very ends, now we can kind of strike our arc, kind of burn down into the tack, and then kind of continue our path up. You won't even notice where it's tacked. Where they've got them here, you'll notice. And then for something like this overlap, there's really not a reason to put that center one in there. That's not going to come apart. So think about where you're going to be putting tacks. When you get into 102, you're going to get prints. You're not going to get really procedure at this point. Those start in welding classes. you're going to get a print, and you're going to need to tack those pieces up. Now think about where the tacks should go. That's part of the grading process, is to see if you kind of can think through the problem, a little critical thinking thrown into it, to see where you think is the best place to put those tacks. Should we add a little bit more? Should we not put as much? Things like that. So, like I say, the rest of the fabrication will be an ongoing thing back there. So, we're going to go into chapter 22 now. Now, chapter 23 is really where the meat of this class is. I'm hoping to really kind of blow through these, this lecture and then next week's lecture, and jump right into the quiz so we can get into 102 as soon as we can. So it's not very long before we're actually in the lab. So we're going to really kind of start right here, even though we started with just some of the general tools. Even if you're not super familiar with everything that you see as far as tooling goes, you'll get really familiar as you get back there and start using it. This is where this kind of list up here comes up. We do have a lot of acronyms again. And because I had someone ask me about testing out this module, I said, very first thing is, if you don't know what those are right off the bat, it's not a good idea to test out this module, because we're going to be dealing with all this kind of stuff. So what we are dealing with here is this. We're dealing with either a code or a standard, and in this case, we're going to call it the same thing, a code or a standard. Now, the code isn't necessarily some kind of legal document per se. It is maybe an industry accepted rules of how to do something, so that would be a code. So if someone says that it's not code, it's not like you're going to get in trouble, there's not going to be an official inquiry or anything like that. It's just that you're not following the rules in which they've decided is the correct way to do it. And there is, and there's validity to this. So back in the early 1900s, the way they put buildings together were with rivets. And if you don't know what a rivet is, the problem with rivets, everybody know what a rivet is? Okay. For those who might be watching on the video, a rivet basically looks like a bolt, but without the threads. And they get heated up to red hot, and there's a plate that holds maybe I-beams together, and there's holes. And those things get put into the hole of the two pieces, and then there's a gun that they use on the other side, it's an impact, and it basically mushrooms the other end to the point where now it's nice and tight. The problem with rivets is that we have an issue with shear strength. So how those handle strength either this way or this way is paramount to keeping a building up. So what ends up happening is you could only go so high because the rivets could only take so much shear strength. So buildings were limited back then on the type of height, and then on the shapes, everything had to be kind of in this boxy grid pattern. So buildings weren't really that different from each other as far as the structures go. Well, stick welding started becoming more and more popular. It really was hard to for the people who were doing structural to really adopt it for a long time. They just didn't understand it, They would see welding, they'd go, oh, that guy's a lizard, whatever. It just didn't make sense to them for a little while that with this rod and this electricity, we could make joints that were way stronger than these rivets that they'd been using for years. But eventually they came around. And what ended up happening was that now designers, architects, they could go all kinds of different shapes. The height became much more prevalent. You could go much higher with welded joints versus the rivets. So it changed a lot. I mean, it was such a huge game changer. So you had this big building boom that was going on. I mean, you know, New York, Boston, Atlanta, Miami, Dallas. I mean, just across the country, all, you know, through L.A., Chicago, Detroit, all the places had a building movement going on. So there was this group that was called the American Wellness Society. It's an industry group. It's not a governing body that, you know, passes laws or anything. It's an industry group. Well, they decided that they wanted to take a look at the welding. And what they found was that in structural steel, all these different places that were building, they're all kind of doing it a little different. And they got them thinking and said, you know, listen, which is the best? So they decided to try to answer that question. What is the best way to do this welding? So they did all kinds of testing, did, you know, different strength testing, combinations of steels, to filler metals, processes, all that good stuff. And they came up with a standard that said that really this is how it should be done. Because if we do it with this and this and this, this is the maximum amount of strength as we can get. But if we do it with this and this one over here, it's not going to be quite as strong, and this technique isn't quite great. So they came up with a standard. And the standard became a code. And that code was the AWSD 1.1 for bridges, buildings, and structural steel. That's a standard that's still in use today. D1.1 is still in use today. They update it all the time. They actually just updated it last year. So that became a standard or a code. Virtually the same thing. But what the AWS then did was that they said that, okay, now not only are we going to do this, we're going to certify people to inspect things under this code. So that became a CWI, Certified Welding Inspector. But the problem with this was that there is a lot of industry out there. And the industries that weren't really included with this said, you know, not a bad idea, it doesn't really fit what we're doing, so let's get together and we'll do another code. So all these industry groups kind of started doing their own thing. There is lots of different codes out there. Whether every one of them is good, you know, that's, you know, maybe up for debate, whatever. But AWS has said, and for the most part, there's three main accepted ones that they feel that, you know, they will create a CWI test, a Certified Welding Inspecting Test out of. And that is the ASME, which is American Society of Mechanical Engineers. That's their Section 9. And that is a standard for pressure vessel and nuclear components. And then the API, which is the American Petroleum Institute, they did a code for pipelines. The AWS, if you go and take their test, you have to designate which one of those codes you're going to do the test under. And they will administer that test. So AWS is fine with, you know, administering a test for a couple other codes. I even sat in a class where a good portion of the class, probably over half of them, were doing the API code. I picked AWS, not necessarily anything, not that it was, you know, better or anything like that. It was just, I didn't really kind of realize at the time what I was going to do with it. It was more of a credential. The bummer thing was when I got in there, the AWS code book was the AA by ATHIC. The API code book was by ATHIC, and I went, huh. So throughout the country, I mean, you know, AWS is recognized throughout. ASME tends to have a pretty good hold up here in the Midwest. API from like Texas up, you know, through all that area is the main code. You know, so you get different areas that use the codes a little bit more than others. But there are lots of them because there's so many different types of industry. I mean, just looking at this quick list here, and this is just a really quick list. You got the American Railroads, the State Highway and Transportation, Aerospace, ANSI, American National Standards Institute has a code, I'm not sure if anybody really uses it. They kind of fall more into the personal protection stuff, but where you see ANSI stuff, but whatever. Another railroad one, the American Water Works, military, the DOD, defense. So there's lots of them out there. There's a lot of carryover. If you look at all the specs throughout them all, they're not that far off from each other, as far as the ones I've seen. So that's where these codes really came from. So it's really dependent on the industry you're in, whether they are using the code or not, or maybe they have their own procedure that they're in. So that takes us into procedure. That takes us into what's called a welding procedure specification, which is a WPS. But let me explain what CWI does first, because this will make sense going into this. So a CWI does a couple different things. They can certify welders. Welder needs to be certified. If he's got, if the CWI has access to a shop or something, he can bring a guy in. He can say, all right, what are you testing under? And basically there's some criteria. It would be process, it would be position of material, it would be groove weld, fillet weld, pipe, it would be thickness of material. So these are all the factors basically that go into it. And that's kind of, to a certain degree, kind of a generic certification. Some companies just want their welder to be certified. It doesn't really matter what it is they're certified in, they just need to be certified. I get calls all the time from HR people, and I'm like, okay, great, what kind of certification do they need? And they're like, I don't know, they just need to be certified. You need a certified welder. Okay, what do you make? So I end up having to play a little sleuthing with these guys and try to figure out what it is the heck they need. If you're not if you don't already have a job, the problem is that the certification is really only good for 6 months. So you pay your money, you get your certification, you basically get a sheet that says you're qualified to weld. It's actually kind of where this one comes in, performance qualification record. So that paperwork is a performance qualification record. We'll get back to that in a second. If they get a job, they can actually kind of re-up that certification every 6 months by having a supervisor say that they welded this particular type of stuff. And if you wanted to put it in the database with AWS, it would cost you some money to get it in there, and then every 6 months you send a check for $10 with the affidavit that says that you've done the welding. Okay. It's fine. I'm not sure necessarily it has to go that far. I'm sure AWS can give you a great reason why it should do that. But that's just kind of my opinion on it. What I see most times with most employers is that they're not really watching the dates on those that much. Not saying that, if you come in with like a 10-year-old certification, that they're going to accept it. But if you come in with a year-old certification, it's probably good enough for a lot of employers. They may want you to be certified again on something specific for their company, but as far as getting in the door, it may be good enough. Okay. So the other side of it is the company come to the CWI and say, listen, we need this welder certified. Now, they may need just one of those generic type of certifications. That's fine too. Or it could mean that it has to be on a certain type of steel. Maybe they're running chrome moly and they need a test on that chrome moly. Or they're running a special aluminum and they need the test on the aluminum. You can do those also. What happens though is if the welder passes those tests, they get a record of that, and it means that the welder's certified, but it has the company's name on it too. So the welder is certified, but if he walks out the door the very next day, he's no longer a certified welder because generally that certification stays with the company. Now, does it help the company? Not really. They could opt to give you that certification if it's just a real generic one and let you take it with you, but you know, companies, some are nice, some aren't. So you kind of, you know, take your chances on that. The other thing is that I can also be hired in to evaluate a welder for qualified. So let me say it this way. Certified welders are always qualified, but not all qualified welders are certified. Okay? Because what we could do is we could do a qualification just to qualify the welder, saying that basically he's qualified to do that weld. Doesn't have to go into all of the testing. It could be that I verify that he knows the procedure, that he went through the procedure correctly, and then I can do a visual inspection on the material and say, yes, he is qualified to make those welds. That's probably a cheaper route for a lot of companies. Maybe they don't need their welders to be certified specifically. It's a lot less time on my side of things, because I don't have to take the pieces and cut them up and do the bend test or whatever. So they could opt that way. So those records are always called PQRs, or performance quality qualification records. Procedure qualification records. So basically, you follow the procedure correctly and everything's good. The fourth thing, this is kind of the big one to a certain degree, is that that procedure has to be written down somewhere. Now, some companies may not even use procedures. That's just the fact of some places here in Michigan, is that maybe they just, welders just do their job, okay? Without any kind of procedure written for that job. Now, is that good? Not necessarily, because it's easier to train someone to do that job if you've got a procedure written down where you can give them the procedure. And you'll know pretty quick whether that guy is qualified to do that job too. Because if he can't read a procedure, he's probably not as good as you think he is. So who writes the procedure? Well, technically it could be the owner of the company, it could be an engineer, it could be a supervisor, or they may even have a CWI on staff. Maybe he's a quality control guy and a CWI. Which I've seen the quality control guys try to take this test. It's pretty tough for those guys. I had a few of them in class that went, "How do you know all this stuff?" I said, "Well, I teach it, so." So what ends up happening with that is that a lot of times companies will hire a CWI to come in, take a look at what they have, and write a procedure. The procedure has to be verified. It can be verified through, like I say, kind of the same steps. It could be the owner that verifies that the procedure is correct. It could be the engineer. It could be a supervisor. Someone's got to sign off on it. The welding inspector is basically number four on the totem pole, essentially, depending on who's working there. So he can write the procedure, then it has to be verified or, welded out and tested or something like that. So that procedure that we are going to work off of is a pretty common type of a recipe for how to do a weld. That's really what we're kind of talking about. And we're not talking about just one of those things where you take this and that and this and throw it in a pan and heat it up. We're talking very specific ingredients, times, how to mix everything together. I mean, it's a lot more specific that way. So we're going to take a look at a welding procedure. Now, it does have a couple little parts here, and I do want you to read through the qualifying and certifying. I'm just going to touch on a couple of things. So just about what I just said, attended welding procedures prepared by a person knowledgeable of the process and technique to be used, and the code or specification to be satisfied. Test samples are welded in accordance with the tentative WPS, and the welding parameters are recorded on the PQR. The test must be witnessed by an authorized person from an independent testing lab, the customer, an insurance company, or other individuals as specified by the code or listing agency. The test samples are tested under the supervision of the same individuals or group that witnessed the test by the applicable requirements, codes, or specifications. If the test samples pass the applicable test, the procedure is completed qualification. It is then documented as qualified, finalized, and is released to for use in production. If the test samples do not pass the applicable test, the tentative WPS value parameters are changed as deemed feasible. So, you know, there is some process here to go through to make sure the welding procedure specification is correct. So we're going to look at a sample one, and I want you to understand, and this is on 556 is where we're going to be starting. Here's the thing, that a welding procedure specification needs to have enough information in there to be very, very detailed. But we also don't want to dumb it down for anybody off the street to try to make this stuff. We want to make sure that it's qualified people that is using this procedure. So those people have to be able to read this. Now we're going to go through it. You might not understand a good portion of it at this point, but you'll get to see it. And then I'm going to give you a quick example of our procedure, our written procedure, which is a little bit less involved than this one. That's what you guys are going to work on. But it's same elements, okay? So basically it says welding procedure specification, number WPS1A, the date for it. The title is welding GTAW of 3-inch schedule 83 16 seamless pipe to 3-inch schedule 83 16 pipe. So we know right off the bat that what is GTAW? Gas compact welding. You know, if you don't know the processes, that's going to stop someone right there. Okay? I mean, that's really kind of what we're looking at. What does schedule mean on a pipe? Any idea? It is wall thickness. It's the wall thickness of the pipe. The 3 inches of the size of the pipe. Anybody want to take a guess at what 316 means? Any idea what it is? Yeah. It's actually stainless steel. Yeah. Which is actually really kind of funny if you really think about it, because I don't know where they got this this from. Schedule 80? This is Schedule 80. This is the thickness of Schedule 80 right here. Most stainless tends to be like this thing?
Yeah.
I mean, this sucker right here is like $60. You know how much Schedule 80 stainless steel pipe would cost? Probably $60 to $70 a foot. I mean, just an outrageous amount. So it's kind of like I read this. Like, who the heck is using Schedule 80? Yeah, it's just kind of funny. All right, so the scope of it is this procedure is applicable for a V-groove welds and piping. So we know what V-grooves are, all right? Within the range of 3-inch Schedule 80 through 3-inch Schedule 80, welding may be performed in the following positions. 1G. What's 1G?
It's flat.
Flat groove, you know, flat welding, it's a groove weld, it's in a flat position. But there is a little bit of a legalese term there. It says may be welded. It doesn't say you have to weld it in 1G, it says it may be welded in 1G. And welding in 1G would essentially be flat like this, and so basically you're going like that. Most welders that know what they're doing aren't going to weld it that way. Most of them are probably going to go vertical to up, turn it again, vertical to up. So, But it says it may be welded to 1G, so it is just that joint can be turned. The base metal shall conform to ASTM A376 grade TP 316 seamless pipe schedule ADP8. So, you don't know what that is? You would. I mean, you know, and you don't have to memorize all of this stuff at all. Just understand kind of a couple little points on there. Again, don't worry if you don't understand a lot of this. It's not my point here. But just understand that this is kind of how these are laid out. ASTM numbers are the numbering system for, or it's an identification system for steel, or for different types of steels. Up here in the United States, or here in the United States, up here in Michigan, in the Midwest, we tend to use actually the Steel Institute numbers, kind of like 1040, 4130, stuff like that. Down south, they tend to use more of the ASTM numbers, and those are it's just a different numbering system for steels. So there's actually a cross-reference. So if you saw ASTM, remember, AWS, though, they're from Miami. So they're going to use ASTM down there. The book has ASTM. You got to have to cross-reference that sometimes if you're in this section. Says a filler metal. The filler metal shall conform to AWS classification number ER316L. So 316 is the filler metal being welded on 316 stainless steel pipe. So it's just a matching filler metal. It says specification A5.9. This filler metal falls in the F number 6 and A number 8. There's these F and A numbers in the code book that give you some different specifications. Again, don't need to even memorize those anyway. Hopefully you got a code book somewhere around if you need to look at it to find out what that is. Maybe you write it on the procedure somewhere. You know, F number this, A number that, whatever. Shielding gas shall conform to the following compositions of purity. Welding grade argon, which is 100% argon. You won't get the joint design on the WPS. You'll get an actual regular print. And so you won't have this kind of filled in there. But we've kind of already seen this. I mean, without any weld symbols on this, we already kind of saw this. So it's a V groove. What is our V degrees? It says right on there. The V, 75 degrees. So our bevel is 37.5. It is giving you a root area, so this is actually going to be a complete joint penetration. They are giving you what we call a land, which is that little flat section. But you can see there's tolerances. So the root is 3/32 to 1/8, and the land is 0 to 1/16 of an inch. So they're giving you tolerances there that it can be prepped however you feel you want it to be prepped. The preparation, that's all information there. You go up to the next page, it says electrical characteristics. We're going to weld this in direct current electronegative. The base metal shall be on the positive side of the line. Parts shall not be welded if they are below 70 degrees. So that means that if it is cold out and you take a temperature reading of the stuff that's under 70, you're going to have to preheat that stuff first, get it up to 70 degrees. There's going to be a backing gas, which, because this is 100% penetration, you have to have gas going through the pipe. So it backs it up from the inside and the outside. Welding technique. This is where, you know, you get some pretty specific stuff. Electrode is 1/8 inch, diameter EWTH2. You have any idea what that means? Okay. Can you decipher that?
I don't know what it does. I'm guessing it's the actual diameter of the tungsten tip, and then I know this isn't a 40-degree diameter of the tungsten.
So there's actually a ton of different types. Yeah, so it's the type of tungsten. So E is actually electrode. W is wolfram, which is the old name for tungsten. If you look at the periodic table, if you look up tungsten, it says W for it. It used to be called wolfram, that's why it's W. TH is thorium, and the 2 stands for a 2% thorium. So it's 2% thoriated tungsten, which is red. Electrotip geometry, how you're going to actually prep the front of it, the nozzle size, the shielding gas flow rate, 20 to 45 CFH. What's CFH? Cubic feet per hour. It's pressure. It's volume, not pressure. We switch it with our flow meter. We go from pressure to volume, so from PSI to CFH. So we don't hit our button and it goes like this because of the pressure coming out of it. We just want a nice little flow of gas over our well. It says that it gives you a current range, and the current range is huge, from 90 to 150. So depending on how you weld, you know, you've got a range there wherever you need it to be. You have filamental type, filamental size, backing gas flow rate, preheat, interpass temperatures. Interpass temperatures are the temperature of the weld as you do a pass, and then what would be the temperature of it as you start the second pass. It says the 500 degrees max, can't go over 500 degrees. So means that as you're welding it, you check it pretty often. If it started getting up there, you may have to back off to say, okay, take a quick little coffee break, come back down the temp a little bit, and then go ahead and start welding again. Tack welds. Now, this next part here, this is not going to be on it. This is way more detailed than you'll ever see. So that's not really what we're dealing with here. So look at kind of one of these ones. This is my 123 class, which is the aluminum TIG welding. How we're going to do it is you're going to get basically your packet, and you'll have a 102 coming up soon. 101 isn't really, I can give you a 101 syllabus, but it's this. I mean, there's nothing extra to it. You've already seen the syllabus for 100. It's the same thing, basically. It's just a couple different chapters. So basically, we're doing 21, 22, and 23. That's the only thing that would be different than that. So if we go to this one, and we'll just take the second one, you're actually going to get a print that basically looks like this. And all it is a square groove, butt joint, flat position. You can see that right off the bat, pretty easy. And then you'll go to the next page, which is the welding procedure specification. So you'll match that up. It'll be project 2, and on the print it says project 2. So it's giving you some information here. It says the weld type is a groove weld, welding process is GTAW. Position is flat, material is 1/8 aluminum. I didn't give you a designation on the aluminum because we have a couple different types. We bought, depends on how much is in my budget, whether I buy 60, 61, or 54, or something or other, which is a little cheaper. But joint type is a butt joint. Backing option, we're going with a PJP, which is partial joint penetration. Polarity is AC. Electrode is 40, 43, that we do have a designation for. That's the type of aluminum filler. Transfer mode, we don't have transfer mode. That's for big, so that is left blank. Tungsten is 2% seriated, which is actually, used to be orange, it's now gray, they've changed it recently. Shielding rate gas is 100% argon, and flow rate is 25 CFH. And then we do have a little bit of a welding procedure with just almost the same information with just a couple things like size of the filler, current or amperage, same term. So there's a couple things there. And then if you go to the second page, you're going to see technique, and this is where I'll just throw some information in there. In this case, it says weld the butt joint, set the balance to 70% AC frequency to 150 hertz. That's stuff that you'll learn when you get into that class. Heat treatment. I don't have anything for heat treatment on the aluminum, so you just dump it in the water when you're done. And then as far as additional notes, in this case, I don't have any additional notes. It just says, show the instructor progress every 30 minutes minimum. So not as quite as detailed, but really, technically, all the information is there except for like, you know, F numbers and A numbers and things like that that are specific. We're not getting into as far as projects for the class. What I do suggest here is that I do suggest kind of going through the, actually, you know what? They show the F numbers and A numbers here. What was the F number? So the F number was 6. Just says the F number is a stainless steel, and the A number was 8. And it's a chromium nickel filler. And it was specification A5.9 and 5.9. So, it doesn't matter at that point. It's still stainless, so it's not, that's why it's not, probably not anymore. But I do suggest kind of going through those practice questions at the end. Don't write them out or anything. Just kind of look at some of those questions, and that's going to help you along with the WPS. Kind of get you familiar with a lot of those little terms and stuff. What we're going to end up doing next week is we're going to be working on, like I said, that's really the meat of the class. We're going to talk about destructive testing, non-destructive testing, and visual inspection. Visual inspection is really the important part of that, because even though, for the most part, as you learn how to weld, I'm teaching you how to weld, I'm going to tell you what you're doing wrong, but I also want you to be able to pick out what is wrong with the weld. The more you learn that, the easier it is for you to come up with the solution on fixing the weld. So I may say, you know, if you bring up a weld, I'm going to say, you know, what do you think is wrong with it? So other than the grading part, I'm still going to be, you know, you got to go through it for your grading anyway, but as you bring up pieces to show me, you're going to need to kind of troubleshoot the problem out. I mean, I'm here to tell you how to fix it. That's not a problem. But if I'm just telling you how to fix it every time, it's not really teaching it all that much. I want you to kind of work out the problem as you go through it with the visual inspection and go, okay, it may be that you feel the bead width is kind of narrow. And I probably would agree with you. I'm going to say, how do you think you should fix that? And you might say you need to go a little slower. Depending on if you picked everything out, I'm going to either say yes or yes, and you also have a little bit of splatter, so it looks like your gap was a little too big too. So get a little closer, go a little slower. So that's how we're going to kind of work this as we go through the projects. That's where kind of my job comes in. Not only just the talking part, but showing you what it is, what's going wrong, how to fix it. By the end, you know, you're going to be able to fix a lot of the issues. I mean, it may be, at some point, it may just be tweaks, you know. I'm going to say, just, you know, change your angle, you know, literally like 5 degrees. Yeah, that's really nitpicking stuff, but once you get to the advanced stages, you should be, that's all you're doing is really nitpicking at that point. The welds themselves actually should look pretty good, you know. So, as far as this part goes, there is a decent amount of info, even though it seemed like we went through it fairly fast. But the good portion is going to be next week. I want to finish up next week so we can really get into the quiz the following week and then get into the lab the week after that. That way you've got the rest of the semester to work on your projects. And if you get your projects done early, great. Then you're done with the semester, essentially, at that point. So you could be, you know, possibly done by April instead of May with, you know, three different modules. So, any questions at this point? No? Everybody good? All right, I'm going to go ahead and kick the video off at this point. If there's anything else after that, it's fine.